And thank you all for coming. Thanks to B&H also for making this space and this time available. This is quite an opportunity for all of us because I enjoy talking about all aspects of photography. And of course, there's nothing more intoxicating right now than iPhone or iPad photography. And we're going to talk about how some of the synergy of the two devices are starting to come together. In fact, you might be noticing that there's some more software coming out now that is iPad only. That's kind of interesting, isn't it? So I think we're going to start to see a little bit of a divide that the iPhone is the gizmo that we use for shooting and maybe doing some stylizing. But then, especially with this new Retina display on the new iPads, which is just stunning, especially for photographic work, that's going to be where we do our editing. And in case I forget to mention it later on, I'll tell you right now, I'm actually writing an article right now for Photo Technique magazine that deals with shooting with a Micro Four Thirds camera, like an Olympus or a Panasonic, and then with an iFi card, which is the SD card that has the Wi-Fi transmitter built in, moving the images wirelessly over to the iPad and working on them. So even out in the field where you have no network, it has direct mode, so you could be out there shooting where you get the optics that you can't get with an iPhone. We love the iPhone, but let's face it, you don't have good depth of field control, you don't have the optics. You can get things like, for Micro Four Thirds, like a 7-14mm lens, and that's like a 14-28, and it's a beautiful lens, so you got this extreme wide angle, but perfectly rectilinear, straight line, stay straight. So you have that kind of control and depth of field. I'll give you another hot tip. The Voigtlander, which they have in stock, at least they did the other day, for Micro Four Thirds, the Voigtlander 25 f.95 lens. 0.95, not 1.95, 0.95. So it's two stops brighter than like a 1.8 lens or a 1.9 lens. I mean, it's amazing. So you have incredible, beautiful bokeh, those out of focus areas in the background, which we can't get except synthetically, which time permitting we'll talk about today. Am I talking fast enough?
Yes.
Okay. And Jill had me on intravenous 5-hour energy as we drove down, getting 48 miles per gallon in our Volkswagen diesel, I might tell you. Pretty cool, huh? Who cares about gas prices? We did every 600 miles we gas up whether we need it or not. So you just got to remember to get diesel and not gas. Okay, so I want to show you, by the way, during this little screensaver thing, these are all iPhone images, and actually a kind of old iPhone images going through here, but I want to give you a little taste of some of the things I've done, and then we'll have a little question period, and then we'll get into the real mechanics. And we got so much good stuff to talk about. I do want to plug, we got a workshop coming up in May at our studio, just 2 hours north of here, which is a couple day workshop. So we'd love to have, we got some people in here, we'd love to get a few more, and we're going to have lots of time to get really into under the covers on all this iPhone stuff. But we're even going to talk about calibrating with a spider, which they sell here, calibrating your iPhone or iPad display. And the spider's the only thing that will do it. Pretty cool. You can profile your iPhone or your iPad, isn't it? So time permitting, we got a lot to cover. Okay, let's jump in here. What's my password? It is nothing. So let's just get right in here. Okay. This, I always talk about the iPhone, that's the Holga Polaroid of the 21st century, except better in every conceivable way. You know, some people will try to fool you that there's more value to their work if it's difficult. Have you run into some of those? And you know, the line I give over and over, there is no virtue to difficulty. We're not after the hardest way to do something. Now there is, conversely, there is some difficult processes are virtuous. I like to think one of the ways I print is platinum over gold leaf from iPhone images. In fact, I'm printing for a show in Houston coming up, and most of the images are from the iPhone. You'll see a few in gold in this little slideshow. But I shoot with the iPhone, make a digital negative, then I'll hand-coded platinum print the image, and then put it's on a very thin vellum, then put 24-karat gold leaf on the back. And they don't look like anything you can get from an inkjet printer. So yeah, it's kind of a pain in the butt, but there's a reason you can't get that look any other way. But these people say, oh, I had to hike 17 miles and my feet froze off and all this. No one cares. No one cares. All right, let's take a look at some of these. You know, I keep showing this. This was my home screen a couple of years ago, and the only reason I still show this same home screen is because so many things have changed since then. Most of these apps that are on here I don't even use anymore. Only a few, and the ones that I still do use, they've been updated and the icons are no longer the same. So it's very interesting that we're in this period of, I call it puberty, and it's like buying shoes for a 7-year-old. They're not going to be the same. They're not going to fit next year, right?
Notice you don't answer your email.
Oh, you mean the 700 some? Yeah, that's bogus. It's much more than that. Yeah, it's much more than that. email. How many of you are getting to the point where email is like an unwelcome intrusion on your lives? It used to be fun, and now it's like a software upgrade. Okay, now then this is something else I used to do. Where do you park at the airport? So you take a picture with your cell phone, right? And I still do that because I'll forget where I parked and you get back a week later or whatever, you know you're in line K. So, and then you start doing things like that Smudgy Bear, our one cat. You start exploring a little more. This is the workflow that many of us do as we start kind of working our way into iPhone photography. And then you might, you know, become such an important model, he gets his own little small astronaut suit. No, this is with an app called Fantasy Lens, which is just, it's wonderful. In fact, there's a self-portrait done with Fantasy Lens. So these are the kind of things you can, I mean, 99 cents. You know, I tell people, 99 cents. You know, you're not marrying this thing for 99 cents. If you only use it and get laughs for 20 minutes, it's cheaper than going to a movie. So, you know, you can discard it. It's not like you're cheating on your iPhone if you throw out an app or don't use it anymore, you know. But you try these things and they're fun for a while and then you mature or you get on, you know, immature. That was done with apps and stuff. Our little dog Trudy, who we lost a year and a half ago, a year and a half ago to cancer. And then I started doing some other things, and there's Jill, you can't see Jill's in the front row here, my wife, and our cousin Jane on the left. So I started doing some other things with the iPhone, and then this was our backyard, and this was stitched in our backyard. Now, how many of you know what stitching is? You know, we stitch with any camera. It's where we take a series of overlapping, the experts talk about like 30% overlap, so we can get vistas that we can't get any other way. And we're going to talk about single row stitching and what I call multi-row stitching, which I think is really where it gets exciting. So this is a single row right up at Poughkeepsie by where the train station is. And that's the Mid-Hudson Bridge over there. And then this is that bridge that's a national park or a state park where you can walk across the Hudson. But all the color control and all the stylizing and texture was done on the iPhone. This is stitched. This is just a few miles from where we live, this little wetlands up there. And they're the Catskills in the distance. But I want you to see the series from which this came. That's the series. Did you notice any difference between that and that? Now you can see how little, and I did shoot vertically. Now this screenshot was done in Lightroom, but it's important that you understand this. The only reason the screenshot was done on the iPhone, you've probably noticed this, you only see little squares. You don't even see your whole image like when you're browsing. So I only did it in Lightroom so you could get a better idea of the entire frame, but none of the work, none of the stitching, none of the color, none of the texture, nothing was done to turn that into that. It was just all done on the iPhone with a series of apps. This is stitched from about 30-some images. This is a single row, and lately I haven't been doing many single row panos, but that is one. That was probably like 5 to 9 images, shooting left to right, overlapping. And here's something important. This is an opportunity to talk a little bit about iPhone workflow. You know, there's nothing, certainly nothing that I do that is difficult. If it were, I wouldn't be doing it or couldn't do it. But the order in which we do things, it's like in Photoshop classes, I tell people, no step in itself is difficult. But you know, when you're working in Photoshop, you miss one little thing and then it all goes haywire, doesn't it? And it makes you feel stupid and makes you feel insufficient, you know, and you start drinking and you know where it goes from there. So, but I tell people, look, when something goes haywire, just back up. There's probably one little thing you missed, it's not a big deal. Just, you know, start over if need be, and you're not stupid, you just missed or did one little thing wrong. So in here, you notice how the trees at the top are blurry and the foreground's fuzzy, but there's like a line of focus, kind of like a tilt shift, and there is an app called Tilt Shift that lets us get that effect that we would get with a view camera if we improperly or non-traditionally use a tilt shift mechanism on the front lens standard. But I also put texture in here. See all this little distress? So it was important that I did the tilt shift effect first and then put the texture in afterwards, because otherwise the texture would have been blurred by the tilt shift and you'd have sharp texture over these buildings, these artifacts, but then it would have been fuzzy on the top and bottom, and I think that would have been kind of visually weird. So the order in which you do things is important. The moon, this is actually called Abandoned Cabins Under Blue Moon. That was dodged with my finger, just on the iPhone. So no Photoshop. This is our backyard 2 winters ago, the hay bale by Wood's Edge. And that is stitched in the texture and the color control. You know the dance. That's just down the road from us, the Catskills. That field is different every time we go by. This is a pinhole effect. Done right there in Palinville. This was stitched from about 30-some images. This is a single image taken from the train going down to the city. This is, I think, well, it's one of the bridges. I don't think it's the Tappan Zee. It's one of the, what's the name of that one? Bear Mountain, or what's that one called? It's not the Rip Van Winkle. It was below Poughkeepsie. Well, anyway, it's a bridge. But this was through the train window, so it's a single capture. Now, you know, you're facing east, you know, as the train goes down. Excuse me, you're facing west. So that was in the evening, so there was nice color, but most of the color and the artifacts. You know, if you there's a place on my website at danburkholder.com where you can sign up for my news alerts. And we're doing an extortion thing this time. So you sign up for our news alerts, and when was the last time we sent one out? 8 months ago?
Yeah.
So your email is not going to be filled up with our news alerts, but we'll do maybe two a year or something. But if you sign up, I'll send you a list of all the apps that I use, and with highlighted actually in green, the ones that I use like on a daily basis versus the ones that are just kind of full and are secondary. But just go to danburkholder.com, you'll see sign up for Dan's news alerts, and then we'll send you the list as a nice big PDF. This trailer, I don't know whether it was a deer blind or what really it was in the woods, but this was stitched. These woods were actually pretty thick in the winter. I want you to see the series from which this came. And there again, I think this is Bridge. This screenshot was done from Bridge, but this was only so you could see the entire series. Now, we're not going to count those, but it's a lot of images, isn't it? I shoot, and this is multi-row, I shoot in what I call a kind of a square S. If this were the scene, I would shoot click, 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 and then come over, overlapping. So I'm shooting in that kind of pattern with the iPhone. Now here, I'm gonna unplug, that's just charging right now. What you don't wanna do when you're stitching, you don't wanna do this. You don't wanna do click, 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 because you'll get parallax, you know, the near-far relationships. You wanna try to keep your lens kind of still in space. You wanna kind of pivot around there. Now you can get gimbaled mechanisms and stuff, but really it's not hard to do. And sometimes if there's a little lack of registration, it can add a certain charm to the image too. So I would shoot something like click, 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 and then pivot over. So I'm going like that. Now it doesn't do that fast because it takes a while for the image to record. But I'm just going click, 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 and then pivoting, overlapping. You know, I said the experts talk about overlapping around 30%, but I can tell you, I kind of got this feeling that, like in Photoshop, the more information we can give the software, the more it can do for us. So the whole purpose in overlapping is to do what? To have common elements, right, in the two adjacent frames so the software knows how to line them up. Well, if you give it a little more common element, it can work even better. So I probably overlap 40 to 50%. The downside is that you have to take more exposures to get the same scene, but you can get some amazing vistas. So there's that scene put together. And now why would there be a picture of a hand here at the end? It's like a bookmark, yeah, because you're out there in the field. Remember, I did this picture in Bridge, so at least you get to see the whole 3x4 picture. On your iPhone, you won't even have that kind of blessing. So that's why I did that hand there at the end and to give that image. Now this shot, there's nothing great about this shot, nothing great about any of these, but this was done for that same train window, well, not the same train window, but the same Metro North train going down. This pole was not tilted. Why is it rendered leaning over? Well, remember how the old focal plane shutters would distort and make race car tires go ovalized? Well, guess what? Even though our iPhone does not have a physical shutter, there is no physical shutter in our iPhones. It's all how the image tumbles off electronically. But the way it tumbles off that sensor is it simulates the way a focal plane shutter would scan across and collect the image. So the train was going down. As the train was going down this direction, this part of the image was recorded, and then as the train moved, it leaned the pole over. Let me show you a more dynamic example. This was on a little commuter plane, and I was sitting near the propeller, so I just aimed the iPhone out the window and just rotated the phone four different ways. That's just turning it 90 degrees. And you don't even have to take the picture to see this. You see it on your iPhone LCD. It's amazing. So that's the kind of distortion we get. It's called a rolling shutter effect. Now this was done on a train ride. This is the Hudson. The camera was pressed up against the glass. This was done with an app called Time Tracks, which turns your iPhone into a slit camera. So it exposed one little row of pixels. So this was probably a 5 to 10 minute exposure, and there was no way to anticipate how that was going to build. It built it one little row at a time. So this is ice on the Hudson River. That's the opposite shore. What do you think all these little stripes are? Those are trees and brush coming between the Metro North train and the river. So I just held the camera up against the glass, and you could see the image getting built. But there's no way to know how that was going to end up. I love it when the photographic process shows its own hand. You know, some people think that the ultimate in photography is to have total control, to have control over the hardware, over the optics, over the software, over the printing devices. I think the real fun comes in when there's serendipity, when the process shows it, puts its mark. You know, when it has like the tattoo or the brand on there, I think that's really fun. That's one of the things that a lot of us get into photography for. This is up at the Cloister. Some of you have been in that room. That was stitched from a lot of images and put together just on the iPhone. In fact, when you see that little watermark I put on with an app called Impression, that's done right before I upload it to Facebook. And that's our backyard. I'm gonna go through these quickly. That's up in Maine when I was doing a little workshop up there. And this is a 4-second exposure handheld with an app called Slow Shutter. Now there are two different apps that will actually have the same name, Slow Shutter. The better one is the one, the icon for it, if you go to the App Store, looks like an on button. It's like a circle with a little line. It looks like an on button on a computer or something. So that's the better one. And this was a buffalo between Saugerties and Kingston. There's a field that they raise buffalo. And this was late at night and there was like a street light over the hill. So that was handheld at 4 seconds, believe it or not. Now this shot, you know where this is, a couple years ago, actually Jill and I were presenting right here, January 2 years ago, and as we left town, it was raining, and I was driving, I said, and it was just beautiful, it was raining, the bridge was wet, and so Jill was next to me, I said, Jill, you got to steer. She said, I'm not going to steer across here. I said, well, someone ought to, because I'm taking pictures, you know, So that usually gets her attention, and so she was kind, she steered, and it's despite all the honking of the cars going by. And so this, I want you to see the straight shot of this. So that's the raw capture. Now this is a 3:4 aspect ratio. That's what we get on our iPhones, you agree? Yeah. Now look at, did I put another one at the end? Yeah, look at this. This is square, is it not? But I want you to notice, look where this image ends on the side. See how that car headlight is right up against the edge, and see how much space we have over between that table and here. But look back there. So that is not cropped, but it is resized. And you know what I found? I found that images that look good as a rectangular sometimes look even better as a square. And if you don't have people in them, you know, no one would know that the bridge is a little bit like 8% or 30% narrower there, but it works. But I didn't want to crop out that headlight over there and come in here, and didn't want to lose that space next to those cables. So you don't always have to crop. You can just, with an app called, what would be a good app for resizing? iResize, which is a wonderful app. Now this, I was teaching down at ICP and was leaving to go home on like a Saturday morning or something, and or a Monday morning perhaps. But anyway, up at the 125th Street Station, this was not stitched. This is a single capture. Now I did use, we're going to talk about HDR. Everyone knows what HDR is, high dynamic range. It's a big thing in photography. I got a few copies of my book on The Color of Loss, which was published, how many years ago, Jill? I don't know. I shot the stuff back 6 years ago. It was the first book done entirely using HDR techniques. So HDR is a kind of a big thing in photography now. And we do it on our iPhones too. And we'll talk about that, time permitting. But this was HDR, two exposures done, probably one for the dark regions, which would be up under the roof there of that little protective overhang thing, and then one on the bright area, which was probably either back here on the sky or down here in the winter. And people sometimes will say, how long do you work on an image? And usually, you know, I think, how many of you have ever worked in the wet dark room? About a third or half of us. Well, you know, you kind of go into a zone in like the silver dark room. And 1 minute it's like 6 p.m. and the next it's 3 in the morning. And you know, you've just lost track. And now that we're working on iPhones, have you found it's kind of the same way? You're sitting there working on an image and you don't really know how time's passing, but that's how we learn. Well, this was one of the few times when I could answer that question, because the train came in just moments after I shot this. The northbound train was over on the opposite side of the tracks. So I hopped on and started working on the image. It's about a 110-minute train ride up to Poughkeepsie, where Jill was going to pick me up. So right as the train pulled in the station, I put the watermark on and uploaded it to Facebook. So for once, it could be quantified. It was 110 minutes. But all the texture, you know, you're making local selections, you know, the texture, the contrast, the color, all done during that train ride. There's some tilt-shift action and some texturizing. This was down at Bryant Park, the Chrysler Building. This was an HDR shot, but is not stitched. As when I was teaching down there, there's the gold version. That's how I print what it looks like when I print it in platinum over gold leaf. That's approaching sandstorm. Now this is a little tiny 3.5 by 3.5, and this is from the plane landing in Newburgh. And you know, it's right when they say turn off all electronic devices. And Jill's like holding up a magazine so the flight attendant couldn't see my shooting out the window. But this is the first one where where I put 24 karat gold behind the top part and then grind up palladium leaf and 24 karat gold leaf to get a cooler feeling and put it on the water down here to get a split tone effect. So we'll go through these quickly because we just got so much to cover. There's a little app, you can barely see it down here, called Muybridgeizer. For those of you that know a little bit about the history of photography, Muybridge did the motion studies with the horse galloping, and he had trip wires, you know, that the horse hooves tripped and fired the shutters, and he was the first person to document that all four of a horse's hooves are off the ground at the same time. This has never been done before. This was the first. I've proved definitively that all four wheels of the Zamboni are on the ice at all four times. So that's another first, ladies and gentlemen. You saw it here. But it automatically puts them as the Zamboni approached. It puts them in. You can even do a grid of, I think it's 4x4 for 16 instead of 9, or maybe it's even more. You know, we're going to talk a little about the built-in camera app on our iPhone and now our iPad. Where we touch, it both focuses there and it meters there, assuming you have the 3GS or later. The original silverback iPhone and the 3G, they were fixed focus. They did not have focusing. But now all of them will, and I'm sure they all will from now on. They've gotten much better. So where we tap, it focuses, but it also meters where we focus. So what if you don't want to have the exposure and the focusing linked? Well, there's some apps. This was done with, I think, Pro Camera. So in this shot of the smoking baby, which is this little ceramic smoking baby a friend gave, I could keep the focus locked on the important part of the smoking baby here, but meter once for the highlights and then take another shot metering for the shadows without shifting the focus and getting a double image. So there are apps like that that are very valuable. My app of choice right now for separating focus from metering point is called King Camera, and they're all very good, but now Pro Camera just did an update the other day, so they keep leapfrogging one another. So you might find yourself, you know, going back and forth from one app to another as they keep getting better. But this was done with Pro Camera. There's one smoking baby that's called Smoking Baby with Time on His Side. This is Smoking Baby about to make a poor real estate decision. And this was using that same Pro Camera, keeping the focus locked on the smoking baby, but metering once for the bright area and then metering in the back area to get a light and dark exposure that was put together with either an app called Pro HDR or True HDR. Those are both very good HDR apps. This was on the cover of, what was the magazine, Jill?
Silver Shots
out of UK. And they were very nice. They approached me and said, we want to run a series. So they did like 14 pages in the cover. And this was stitched from, I think it was 68 or 78 images. And this was one of the few, and this is where I will stand up just a little bit here. This was done with the iPhone 4 at the time, because that's what I had, with a tripod. And I want you to see this very neat bracket. And I only have one of these brackets with me to sell, and it's already been spoken for. But this lets you mount your iPhone. And this is a great Benro that I got here at B&H. It's a wonderful, man, it's just so light, it's amazing. And it's got the good quick release head on that honors the Arca Swiss standard. So this bracket is made by Kirk. And here's what's so cool. So if you're shooting a horizontal, that's fine, but look at this. Isn't that easy? To go to shoot a... It's Kirk, K-I-R-K.
Okay,
yeah. But they should, if they don't have them here, pester them to get them here so you can buy local. But yeah, Kirk Photo, but isn't that nice? And they got nice detents in there. So it's just a real joy. Now they made this special one with the sparkle finish on, you have to pay extra for that. But they made that one for me, which was nice of them. Yeah, you can see the cross section. We need Vanna White up here, don't we? And they even, they've just done everything right on it. So it's from Kirk. And they do carry Kirk products here, but I don't think they have that. And this, the piece that actually clamps your iPhone, this is for the 4 or 4S, is actually Delrin plastic, so it will not mark. It won't scratch it. It looks like metal, but this really beautiful high-density plastic. And the rest of it is anodized aluminum. So it's a really cool thing. And they will let you do, what I was getting at, this shot was done with a tripod. It's probably the only shot I'm going to show you in here that was done with a tripod. That's a gold leaf print of overlapping trees in our backyard. And I think we do have sound. I'm going to show you a few seconds. This was done with a little app called Film Director here. Yeah, it puts the artifacts in. This is on that same train ride. Aren't you getting sick of that train ride? So, but it does, yeah, it's all kinds of fun stuff you can do like that. This is up in the Catskills. There again, all that was a single HDR shot, but cropped. Actually, I might have squeezed that down, I think, to make it a square. And all the border and effects were all put in there. This image is in the book. In fact, I just printed this, the best print I ever made the other day to go to the Houston show in platinum over gold leaf. This was, this was like 80 some images. This was handheld up near Saugerties on 9, and found this old abandoned church, semi-abandoned, there along the side of the highway, and that multi-row stitching and put together on the iPhone. And we're gonna talk about that. I'll go through, here's some gold leaf prints, go through these quickly, all done. This is from the train ride, that's the Indian Point nuclear power plant there, coming down, shooting out of the train. You know where that is? I think that's the Tappan Zee, isn't it? Yeah. And that's up in the Catskills, the cabin with the snow in the spring. And that's a self-portrait. Now, frankly, I think all the images you saw, I do on my iPhone, but I'm gonna present here from the iPad because it's just a little easier when I'm talking to you guys to work here. But I really do almost all my work here. But we mentioned that new trend where we're gonna do a lot of shooting with the iPhone and moving them over. So you can see how I have my images organized here. Now, I do want you to see something here. If we go into General About, and we come down here. Do you see, applications, that's the space, but how many? Where does it say how many? Yeah, 650, there it is, applications, 650, yeah, it was 650 applications. You don't have to have this many. And a lot of those are junk, they should make a TV program on hoarders, yeah, like iOS hoarders. you're afraid to get rid of stuff, but that's okay, and that's why I buy a big capacity. So let's just look. You can see on this first screen, really, I don't have much photographically here on the first screen. I got tools for writing, shopping, news, all these different kind of things. But then it really gets into the right on the second screen is where it gets into all the good photo stuff. And there's King Camera, and I want to demonstrate something here for you. I have a whole app of cameras here. I'm going to launch this guy called Gyro Lens. How many of you use Gyro Lens? And we might get some flare because, okay, I want you to see. Now, you can see I'm holding this upright, and you can see. Now, watch as I tilt. I cannot, with Gyro Lens, I cannot take a crooked picture. Do you see how the door is still straight? This is no tricks except electronic. Look at that. It uses the gyro, and oops, I hit the home button there by mistake. It uses the gyro it's even better on a 4 or 4S, it has a gyroscope. But isn't that amazing? You cannot get, so if those of you have trouble keeping the horizon straight, it's incredible, isn't it? Yeah. Just amazing. And there's, I keep another folder called, where is it, Piano. There it is, the Piano folder up here. And how many of you have used PhotoSynth? This is like the poor person stitching app. And this is so fun to demo. I don't use it for serious stitching because it is a little handicapped resolution-wise. But it's amazing. And if you're at a party and just need to do a quick demo, or a quick stitch, there's nothing faster. So I'm going to demonstrate here. And I want you to see, tap to start. Even I can figure that out, right? You launch it and watch. I'm going to tap here. We are getting some flare. Let me clean my lens. I always clean it with the very best stuff. There we go. Yeah. All right. That's not better. I didn't do the proper circuit or rub. Well, it's just flare. See, if I create a lens shade, see, that's why you should use lens shades on your camera. See that flare? People say, should I use the lens shade? I'll see students, they have the lens shade on backwards. I say, what the dickens are you doing? Well, I got the lens shade on. Well, yeah, but it's not doing anything except getting in the way so you can't focus or zoom. Okay, now watch, tap to start, and then watch. Now, you can't hear that little click, but every time it senses, I'm not hitting any more buttons. Every time it senses a new fresh area, look at that, it's building it on its own. See that? Isn't it amazing? Now, it might have trouble over there because it's dark. We don't have the lights up, but can it get that shot? Yeah, it got that one. And how about down there? It got that one. It's going to.
What's the name of this app?
What, you hear that question, what's the name of the app? This would be a good time to discuss instructor gratuities. Would it not? No, just kidding. It's PhotoSynth. S-Y-N-T. I think that was photo. I'll show you for sure. And I said we're going to take questions when I finish that. Let's just click. I'll get one more spot. I'm kind of moving around here. It hits finish. I just want you to see what this does. Stitching panorama. Look, it even shows all the pictures there we just took. This is the first time I've ever done it on the iPad 3, for lack of a better term. So, okay, we'll say done, and let's look, there it is. There's that one we just did there, and people were moving around during that. Let's save this to the camera roll. And look, it brings up the cropping rectangles. I'll just bring in to get, we always have those little scalloped edges, right? So I'll just bring the little crops down to get rid of the scallops, and we'll hit save. And let's go, it says save to camera roll. Let's go look in our camera roll. And now, this is called your tray down here, right? And that doesn't move. So put the things that you use a lot down in your tray. And notice I keep photos, so I can get to my photo libraries quickly, and the app store, because I'm there like every day checking for new apps. And why I keep this there, Lord knows, because I never check it. And Safari, and this, in case we don't get to it, Photo Sync, for syncing, for moving images from your iOS device. When I say iOS device, that's just a shortcut for either iPhone or iPad. I used to use a really good one called Photo Transfer App, which was, it's excellent, but this is even better. This Photo Sync was, a good friend Harry Sandler told me about this, and someone had told him, and they were all right, it's really good. And what's it cost, like $1.99 or something? But it will let you send images to PC, Mac, any direction, and it works beautifully. So get that one if you want to send images. In fact, when I was writing the book iPhone Artistry, I didn't use a cable one time to move images from my iPhones, and I was shooting with three different iPhones when writing that book. So I used the predecessor to this, Photo Transfer App, to wirelessly, just so you're on the same Wi-Fi network, and they'll also work on Bluetooth. Now, Photo Transfer, I'm not sure about this, I haven't tried this one on Bluetooth, but Photo Transfer App will work with Bluetooth also. So if you're out where you don't have a laptop to make an ad hoc network, you can go from iPhone to iPhone, iPhone to iPad, any direction with Bluetooth. So you want to get something like that. Let's take a look at that by hitting the photos and go into the camera roll. And I actually just moved off like 2,000 images off this morning. So we'll go down here. And there's our cropped image on that guy. But that's pretty cool, isn't it? And look, we got from this gentleman here was moving around because look, his head is kind of leaving his body. Or it might be the rapture, I don't know. So we got from him here over to all the way over to that chair and the edge of the sign. So that's like about 100, it's almost 180, maybe like 170 degrees we got there with one tap of the finger with an idiot driving the thing. So, I mean, how can you beat that? And that app, and I told you I'd show you the name of it again, there it is, Photosynth, S-Y-N-T-H, is free. Okay, so notice how I've organized my apps. I got one for texture, one for sketching, and obviously this is why we have, longer workshops, we get into all this kind of stuff. But I want to talk about something that's kind of very trippy. See this app down here, Spider Gallery. Because I don't want to miss talking about this. This is a Spider 4, and there are three flavors of this. I bet they have them all in stock here. They make, like Baby Bear, Mama Bear, Papa Bear. So this, I think, is their Papa Bear. This is Spider 4, but any of the Spider 4s, no matter whether you buy the cheapest or the most expensive, will do this. It will let you, we just got to be on the same Wi-Fi network, but it's very trippy. You just launch Spider Gallery, you got it, because our Wi-Fi here is configured a little bit differently. I'm not going to take the time. You click Calibrate Viewer, you make sure you're on the same Wi-Fi, you set that guy on there, and it looks for the Spider, the application on your desktop, it brings it up. It's amazing, and it goes through the colors just like it would on your desktop. So, but Spider is the only company, X-Rite and the others, they do not have any provision for calibrating your images on your iPad or iPhone. But I can show you, if we go to the gallery, let me go in here and show you. Let's go into like here. Now remember, this is already kind of dumping shadows, but let me take like the cover image from The Color of Loss. Let's zoom in here. And there's less shadow detail on the iPad. But see, I got calibration turned on. I don't know if you're going to see it up there or not. I can see it on my screen. Yeah, the vagaries of the projection system. But on here, and if you come up while I'm shutting down at 6 o'clock, if you want to see this, the shadow detail is better and the color is better on the calibrated version. So it's pretty neat. So if you want to calibrate, if you're into that kind of geeky stuff, which I certainly am, because I want the best color possible, consider getting yourself a Spider. The software is free, and any of the Spiders will do it. Now, let me check my list of all the things that I wanted to do and expose you guys to. This would be a good time to take a few questions while I'm checking. So far, any questions?
Yeah, now, how's the best way? I just got the iPad, so I have the iPhone. But how's the best way to transfer the photos back and forth?
The question is, what's the best way to transfer photos back and forth from iPhone to iPad?
Yeah, and especially if you're not Wi-Fi connected certain area?
Well, like I said, I don't know, because I've only started using this with Wi-Fi, if that supports Bluetooth. Photo transfer app, definitely. Notice I have a whole folder called photo sharing. So if this one does not support Bluetooth, which would work out in the field, this one called photo transfer app, and there's the icon, that is wonderful. It's only slightly, you know, it's not quite as slick as the photo sync. And notice there's the app iFi that you get from, if you go to i.fi, you get that little 8 gig is the maximum, the iFi card. It's SD card only. But now the new 5D Mark III takes SD card. All the Micro Four Thirds take SD. The new Nikon 800 takes SD. And you can even, if you buy the best Pro X2 iFi card, you got your choice of sending JPEGs, videos, and RAW files over. So you can use it now. If you're moving over to the computer, I think use a cable or use a card reader. It's going to be faster. So, but it's really fun out in the field with like a Micro Four Thirds and your iPad. You know, I'm shooting images now where there is no computer involved and no stinking Photoshop involved. I love Photoshop. We love Photoshop, right? We love Adobe, but they keep sucking us dry. But they're seeing their writing on the wall, and that's why they've come out with software, which I'm only going to allude to today. They just recently came out with, we've had some really great additions in just the past couple weeks. One of them, where did I set my laser down? Oh, here it is. One is Photoshop Touch. Now you can see lots of tutorials. I'm not going to launch this today, but Photoshop Touch is really pretty genius. But for some reason, Adobe kind of, they lean towards making it everything happen quickly at the price of resolution. You can't do an image bigger than 1600 pixels by 1600 pixels. So you do the math, and what's that work out to? Like a 2 megapixel image or something. It's not that much, right? So we're shooting with these 8 megapixel cameras, so who wants to throw away 2/3 of it? You can bet that that's going to change very shortly. But that's the future, and it supports layers. You can even save. This even has built in a feature called Creative Cloud, which we all know about cloud storage, right? So Adobe's Photoshop Touch, they got these tutorials and everything in here, but it will let you save images up onto what they call, see that upload to Creative Cloud? It's free space they give you. This app supports layers like in Photoshop. If you save it to the cloud, you can open it from Photoshop on your desktop computer and all your layers are intact. It saves it as a PSDX file. Now, if you just save it to like your own iPhone or over to a synced folder on your desktop, which you can do from this, but it will be flattened. It'll be a flattened JPEG. So it's pretty neat that they've given you this free space on their cloud, the Creative Cloud, and even the layer integrity stays the same. That's a blowaway, right? But it's the resolution's kind of hampered. But give it, you know, it's brand new, so give it some time. Let me check my list here. Are you having fun yet?
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
On the list of apps that you're going to email us from your website, mm-hmm. Does it give any description of
yes.
What the app does?
Yeah, the gentleman asked if the PDF that I'll send you if and when you sign up for my news alerts, does it have a description? Yeah, it does. It has a short description. It'll even say, you know, what it does best. Because some apps, you know, try to be a jack of all trades. So I've tried to isolate what does each app really do the best. Okay, and so that will be in there. So yeah, thanks for asking about that. Let's talk a little bit about HDR, and you'll notice that I have a whole folder here called HDR, right? High dynamic range. And trust me, I haven't used a lot of these in a long time. This is a new one though, it's kind of fun, refi. But I haven't used HDR artists, not to say they're not good, but the two real winners here are these two, True HDR and Pro HDR. And people will say, well, what's the best one, or in this case, the better, since it's a comparative. But, you know, it's hard to say because they also keep leapfrogging one another. I'm kind of favoring True HDR. I'll give you a little heads up. The one negative with True, it does seem to crop a little bit off the edges of your picture. So if you have something where there's a pole or a person, it's important that they stay completely in your photo. You might find that Pro HDR does not cut off the edges, doesn't crop into your image quite as far, but they're both excellent. Bracket mode, since we're talking about shooting, bracket mode is dynamite. And let me launch bracket mode. This is not optional. You got to get bracket mode, and I think it's 99 cents. And I'm going to hold this up, and it will work here. Now, we're getting that flare, but I just don't have enough hands to, you know, to block that out for you. So just picture a nicer image than when I take my hand away. Now, you can use it in automatic mode. I could just hit this button, and it would take two exposures, one for the darkest region that it's going to find in the scene, which will probably be maybe back in here since we got flare down here, and then one for the brightest region, which will be either there or back on that wall. But I like to see where it's making those judgment calls. So if you hit this icon, watch what it says on screen. Do you see how it says manual mode for just a second there? Did you see that? Here, I'll go back and turn it off. See, automatic mode, but I like to tap that. And it shows you, and sure enough, there, it picked that area automatically as the darkest area in the scene, and that area. So when I hit the shutter button, it's going to take two pictures. Now, do I have my volume turned all the way up?
Handheld?
I think so. Yeah, you try to, yeah, I mean, this would be even better on a tripod, but watch this, I'm going to. Now, I just took two pictures and saved them. Now, you know, one of the things, and write this down, whenever you get a new app, you want to do two things. You want to check on settings within the app itself, which is the, usually the settings looks like a little gear, or sometimes it'll say settings. And you always want to check for what your options are. Notice they do have a self-timer. So if you were on a tripod and you wanted to make sure that you're not stabbing that button and shaking things, you could set it for a couple of seconds or up to 10 seconds. Auto-save, I recommend turning that on because, you know, when I shoot the picture, I want them to be automatically saved into my camera roll. If you don't have that turned on and the default is turned off, you have to do one extra step to save. It was just kind of like, you know, it's optional, but I like to have them automatically saved. Now let's look at those two pictures that it just took. Let's go and look in our photo album, and there's that beautiful picture of you guys. So let's scoot, and there they are. There's the dark one where it was metering up here on the brightest area, and there's the light one. And you can see how those are two different exposures, right? So I mean, they're not good pictures. Let's use something like True HDR. Now True HDR, people remind me later. I always say remind me later, and I never write a review, never. But I hate to say no. You know, there's a book out like The Power of the Creative No. I haven't learned that yet. You believe in the power of the time wasting, do it later. Okay, now you can, from True HDR and most of the other HDR apps, you can shoot from within the app itself, auto capture. Then they have semi-auto and manual capture. There's really not much difference between these two. But I like to use bracket mode and shoot, because a lot of times I'm stitching. So the last thing I want to do is have to shoot each series here. If I use auto capture here, it would do a fine job. But say I set up, tap the camera button, hold still while we take three pictures. Now what's the three picture deal? Well, let's try it. Let's shoot this. See what it's doing? It just took three pictures, but only two are used. The first one is an evaluative exposure, where it's looking at the scene and finding where the dark areas and light areas are. So it's not melding three together like we do with our digital SLRs or Micro Four Thirds or anything. So we would put those two together. But then I would have to hit merge, and then I'd have to do an estimating transformations, aligning images, preparing final result, and then you could play with the settings. And it's fine, but if you're combining HDR with stitching, do you want to do that for every little pair and then pivot? No. You want to use bracket mode to get dark light, dark light, dark light, and then later put them together with your HDR weapon of choice. So I want to talk about that because it's a very important concept. Does that make sense? So this works great for a single scene, but if you're combining it with stitching, it'll drive you nuts. So let's launch True HDR. So I'll go back to home. I don't want to save those. So instead, we would use choose pictures, the ones we shot before using bracket mode. So we'll tap there. Oh, believe it or not, I got off track in one thought. I was recommending that whenever you get a new app, that you go into settings, and we're in a different app here now. So look, you got two different choices, natural or enhanced. So if you like the whack out HDR look like you see on the web a lot, this would be a way to get it. If you want a more kind of natural, realistic look, so there's no right or wrong here. And you can all, if you were shooting from within here, you could have this automatically save them, but I don't shoot from within here. You want to check, whenever you get a new app, you want to check within the app itself, just like we did here and like we did for bracket mode, but you also want to go into your iOS settings. So you want to check two different places within the app itself, and then you want to go in here and see all these guys down here. After you get below store, some apps, not all of them, will put their own settings in here in your iOS settings for like the 6x6. That's a square shooting app like a Rolleiflex. So we tap on there. Well, there are lots of choices in there. You'd have to study that a little. Sometimes they'll have a thing for resolution. I don't know if I've even set this before. You can have the volume button if you want your volume up button to work as a shutter, which you can now with iOS 5 and later. You can turn that on. So a lot of them will have different kinds of things. Let's just see. I'm going to go down here. Like Blender. There's a Blender which is for blending apps together. Blah, blah, they got some options in there. So check those two places because some of them will have a resolution setting and often they'll choose a lower resolution because things will happen faster and you want to get the maximum resolution you can out of these guys, right? Like Paint Me, is that one that has, JPEG quality for instance. We're checking Paint Me, which is a painting application. And I don't remember if that was the default. I doubt if it was probably medium, but maybe it was higher, but I'm gonna put high S. I want the best quality on that, right? So check both places whenever you get a new app. Now it will remember your settings. You don't have to do that every time you use the app. Once you change them, it'll stick. So just keep that in mind. For any app, not just photo apps, but for any apps you get, whether they're PDF readers or markup apps or anything. That the iPhone and iPad, they come with their built-in camera and if we open that up, do we have that on here? We don't on here, but on the iPad, we have options for HDR. On the iPhone, we have options for HDR. It is fast. It shoots three, but really puts two of them together. It's quick. But I've run tests like driving across bridges, and it's not quick enough. You still get double image and the cables and stuff. So really, you're not going to shoot anything moving with any of these HDR apps. Just like you would with your big camera. You're not going to shoot a sporting event in HDR, right? Even if you've got a Nikon that'll shoot, 9 frames a second or something.
Well, I guess my question is the app you showing us much, much better than the built-in?
Yeah, the question is, are these apps better than the built-in HDR on the iPhone 4 and 4S? Yes. The only virtue of the built-in HDR is that it's faster than the others, and it's free, it's built in. But in terms of quality, actually, it tends to, when you use the built-in feature, which I just don't want to switch the cable back and forth, or I could show that on here, it tends to also do a little bit of sharpening to the final image. It skin tones look kind of weird, and sometimes kind of solarized also. So no, when I'm doing real HDR, I'll use one of these apps, like bracket mode, and then use true HDR or pro HDR.
Dan, you're making us sick.
Oh, I'm sorry, I'm moving this all around. Yeah, sure am. Okay, so, all right, let's get back to, now remember you can, when you double tap on your home button, it brings up, what's this called? This is Process Viewer. These are all the apps that are running in the background here. And if you the multitasking on the iPhone 4, iOS 4 and later, now we're up to 5.1, it's good, but it's not perfect. So if you've never forced quit any of these, you might be surprised. Some of you might not know this, but double tap on your home button quickly and it brings this up. So these are all things that we've launched just today, like I launched this right before coming to class, an auto stitch, which we're gonna talk about. Gyro lens, but sometimes you might have 40 to 70 things running concurrently in the background. And Apple says, oh, they're really not using RAM. BS. They are. In fact, there is a utility that I have in here. Actually, I got an iOS utilities here. See this folder called iOS utilities? See this guy called MFlops? That's for MegaFlops. That's a little utility that if you launch that, and if you have a lot of apps running, it's a one-trick pony. It costs like a dollar. And it will actually, this is not a joke, this reads the speed of your machine and you can run this once with all those apps running in the background and then force quit them all and run it again and you'll see your speed go up. So that's a little guy called MegaFlops, which if you're a geek, will be helpful. Okay, now let's get back to true HDR, load those two images in. So I'm gonna take these two, the dark one and the light one, and I tap on the first one. Notice it just says pick the second image. This is another thing I like about true HDR. It doesn't dictate that you load the certain one first. Pro HDR will tell you that you have to load like the lighter one first. Not a big deal, but you gotta make sure you do it the way it says. True is a little more flexible, so I'm just gonna tap on the light one and it loads those in there very quickly, or light and dark. Then we'll tap merge and it goes through the same kind of math we saw before, aligning images, combining dynamic range. For anyone who moved from an iPhone 3 to a 4 or a 4 to a 4S, you really appreciate the speed difference. And there it comes up with our final version. You can, if these are in the way, you can tap this little slider icon and it will put those away. See, I'm just tapping down there. So that's pretty nice. You also have some effects, but frankly, these effects are pretty rudimentary and rather cheesy, except for the vignette. You know, everyone likes a vignette. But you can turn that off with a second tap. There's no off, you just tap it again. So you can play with those on your own time. I usually do not apply an effect. Sometimes you can benefit from tweaking these. For instance, the contrast, especially on your image up there, is a little bit high. So you can fine tune this. So you'd want to get that as good as possible before saving that to your camera roll. Now, here's the important part about HDR, and this merits spending a few minutes talking about. I love stitching, and people say, do you stitch to get big resolution? Well, there's actually, if you go into the stitching program of choice, Auto Stitch, and you always want to check your settings, right? We'll tap that little gear up there in Auto Stitch, resolution. Now, and we'll talk about resolution and blending. We're not going to get into all this stuff about geotagging because it takes too much time. But resolution, you can do a low, standard, high, or advanced. For instance, on low, it tells you the panorama will be rendered at 30% of the input resolution. That's how many images are you throwing in, limited to a maximum of 3 megapixels. We don't want that, right? So let's look at standard. Well, 50% of the input limited to a maximum of 5. That's getting better, and if you were on iPhone, you know. But still you're throwing maybe like, you know, 28 megapixel images in there if you're shooting with a 4S. So on high, you're still only getting to 10. That's why they gave us advanced, right? So you're not gonna get more than 10, but if you tap on advanced, then you get to choose like what percentage of the input do you want, and what's the maximum size you want to get out. So you can get up to an 18 megapixel out of here. Even on like an iPhone 4, which is only a 5 megapixel image. Now, here's something you want to keep in mind. You can crash this app. If you try to throw too many images in and ask for too big an image out, it's sort of like, you know, like columns on a view meter. You can't have the maximum going in and the maximum out, or it'll crash it. So if you find it crashing, it won't hurt your images, it won't hurt your iOS device, you'll just have to restart it. But if you throw too many, and say you're trying like 120 images you dump in here, and that's not without possibility, and you're trying at 100% and 18 and it crashes, you're going to have to take one of these down. I would try maybe taking this down to 50% because you're throwing so many in there, you don't need to try to get the full res out. So, and if that still crashes, maybe if you're throwing a lot in, I might take the input even down to 30%. And if it crashes, well, then you got to make a call, and you might have to settle for 10 megapixels. So just keep that in mind, that if you're trying to stitch too many images, and they're big, and you're trying to get too much out, you're gonna crash it. Now, the iPad 3, for lack of a better term, they call it the new iPad, it now has a gig of working RAM, whereas the previous models in our iPhones have 512 megabytes of working RAM. So if anything, for processing, I would think, and I haven't verified this, you know, empirically, but these should be able to stitch more images. Does that make sense? So we might find out now. But I want to show you something I did earlier. Let me show you a few weeks ago. Jill and I went up to the Finger Lakes and shot a scene. I'll show it's down here. I think I put it in here. Blah 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 blah. That's our yard there. We got one of Oh, here's a shot I did the other day. Isn't that a nice little shot? Yeah, sure. And look at this. Jill and I just bought this on Saturday. It's a 1960 NSU Prinz. It's got a two cylinder air cooled rear engine in it. Yeah, what a money pit that's gonna be. But in a previous career, I was an import auto mechanic, so I still get sucked into stuff like that. Now, this shot, look at this. Up in the Finger Lakes, it starts here. Do you see how that's the light exposure and that's the dark? Here, let me make them bigger. So this was with bracket mode. And this is actually the corner of a street sign. So standing there with the iPhone, this is the 4S right here. So that's the light one. So bracket mode did that, and then it did that. And then the next pair, I pivoted over a little bit. See how? See, I moved a little bit to the right. See how far that building comes out? And the next one, That's pretty or did I move down? I guess I moved down a little bit. Yeah, down a little bit. That's a pretty minor move. They're overlapped a good bit. So there's the light, the dark, the light, the dark. So you get the plot. So I did that square-shaped grid for those guys. So it starts here and ends down here, right there. Now, we're not going to count those, but it's a fair number. It's like 30 or something images. And I'm not going to take the time because those are all 8-megapixel images, and it takes a while to stitch that many. But I want to show you, and this is an important part of our talk here today. When you combine stitching with HDR, which I think you got to try this. If you got the iPhone and you love photography, you got to put these two together. You got to combine stitching and HDR. Unlike drinking and driving, these two you want to do at the same time. So these, you can get better tonality from the HDR, and you can get these spatial relationships from the stitching. And you combine that, you put that together, and you can get amazing image quality. And one of these I just printed in gold, platinum over gold the other day, and it just looks of this image. Now, think about how many different ways we can do this. Bracket mode gave us the lights and darks, lights and dark. We could dump all of these into auto stitch. What I call that the all-in-one bucket approach, right? Where you take all your lights and darks, no matter how many, and dump them in auto stitch. And you try to get the max res. If it crashes, we talked about you set it down a little bit. And I've already did that before class. I'll show you the result. If you get really nice tonality, that's the easiest way to combine stitching with HDR, isn't it? Because you're just taking all your lights and darks and putting it into auto stitch, and you're hitting stitch, and it's doing the rest.
So you use auto stitch after you.
Yeah, you shoot the series like this, and then the question is, how would I do that? Well, I would launch auto stitch. I'll just start doing it, and I would go into select down here where it says select photos, and then you would go into your camera roll, and that series starts. I'm in the wrong album here. Let's see, camera roll. So that one started. Did I go into the right one? Am I just on the wrong end? They're up here a ways. So yeah, here they are. So let's go up to the beginning of those. Rip, there it is, right there. So I would do tap, 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 tap. You know, I'd do all those and then hit stitch, and it would put those together.
You don't have to separate the darks from the lights.
You're getting, the question is, from this lady who interrupted in the front? No, Sarah's a friend. You don't have to separate the lights and the darks. No, they're not like eggs. Okay. But we will talk about that, because no, you're asking the right question. But I like to do it remember we said there's no virtue to difficulty? So try the easiest way first. Let me show you the results of when I did that. I threw all of them into auto stitch, and in our camera roll down here at the bottom, I saved that, and it is right here. So that was letting auto stitch, putting all those lights and darks in there. That's what auto stitch did, okay? And that's the result. Then I took, that's that first method. Get back there. Then I took all the lights and stitched. And see, this is stitching all the lights together. So this is dumping all the lights and darks. The sky detail, this banding is just something that, because we're mirroring, you won't get that in your image, that kind of banding. That's just because we're sharing video RAM between here and the projector. You won't get that in your real image. So that was, and also, of course, factor in about a stop brighter shadows in here, too. So this was stitching all the lights and then stitching all the darks. So, first method, the easiest, is all in one bucket. Is that our question here? I'm going to ask you to hold that a little bit, but, well, go ahead.
Can we see the dark? So the program, initially you said that the program combines the light and the dark.
That's the first method you try. And if you like the tonality, that's when you put all the lights and darks into auto stitch. We call that the all in one bucket method, okay? And if you like the results, you're finished. That's the easiest way, right? Because you're not having to separate the eggs. But then if you say, well, the sky is still, and that's the one, that was the all-in-one bucket method. And that's what it came up with. And whereas this was the lights and this was the darks. But see how much richer the sky is in this one? So the second method is what? You do all your lights, you stitch them, save it. Then do all your darks, save it. And then you use an HDR program to put those together, okay? So let's do that. So on here, see, there's the one that I saved where I didn't want to take like 3 or 4 minutes of our time stitching all those together. So there's the one where we put all of them together, but then I stitched just the lights and the dark. So we're going to take an HDR weapon of choice, like true HDR, and put those two together. So let's go back to, I don't have that running anymore. So let's launch, let's go to our HDR folder and launch true HDR. And we're going to do, remind me later, choose pictures, and go into our camera roll. And those are, that's the one that was automatic. That was the all-in-one bucket. We're going to take this one. And then when it says choose the second image here, there it goes. These are pretty big images probably. Pick the second image. I'll tap on that darker one there. And I think it took my tap. Yeah, there it goes. These are just pretty big images, right? So there's the one stitch all the lights, all the darks. Let's tap merge and put those together. Ooh, what's this message say?
You must have the same dimensions.
Yeah. All these, I haven't found an HDR app yet, and I don't know why they can't be more forgiving than this, but the two images have to have exactly the same pixel dimensions, or they won't go together. So what are we going to do? Are we messed up? I would have said a word that needed to be edited out, but no. No, we got to change one of those to match the other. So how do we find out how big those two images are? And I'm going to ask someone with a pen like Sarah to write these down so I don't have to. Well, there is a wonderful app that is free. And notice there's a whole folder here called, let's see, where do I keep it? Crop and Resize, I believe it's in here. Yeah, on here I keep in this folder called Crop and Resize. On my iPhone, I use it so much, I actually keep this one down in my, or out on the root level. Photo Size from Danny Goodman, and he emailed me to thank me for mentioning him in the book. It's a free app. I mean, he's not making a dollar on this thing. Well, he has some ads in it. I guess the advertisers pay him some. But he's done a great service for the photographic community. This is a one-trick pony, Photo Size. So watch, when we launch it, it just says choose photo. So let's go into the camera roll, and we're going to choose first this one, which is where we put our lights. So can someone write down these two dimensions, Sarah, is it going to be you? So it's 5494 by 3276. And I use this all the time.
Do you want the total?
No, we don't. No, we don't need that. But thanks for asking. Now that's just a hair under 18 megapixel, isn't it? So let's look at the other one. We're going to look at the one where we threw all the darks into auto stitch. That's already been done. Now that's a little bit bigger. That's a hair over, but they're slightly different. So can you write this one down, Sarah? It's 5478 by 3286. So this one's a little bit bigger, right? Because the other one was 17.9 megapixel. So let's take the second one down to match the size of the first one. Okay, we got to make them the same size. And here's a quiz question. I mentioned one app was good for resize. Remember when the George Washington Bridge, we talked about taking a 3:4 aspect ratio and turn it into a square. What app did we use for that? Yeah, so you guys are good. And where is it? Right there, iResize. Now, there are other apps that will do this too, but I kind of like these guys that launch faster, one-trick ponies, and they're just no nonsense, and they do a great job. So let's choose the photos, tap on photos, and we're gonna resize that second larger one, which is this guy here, right, the dark one? So we'll choose that, and it opens that up. And they give you a little helper, like the first time you read it, you know, it comes up here and tells you stuff. So I'm going to set up here, I'm going to tap resize. Now they have set up quick resize. That's a kind of a neat feature. If you're always taking your images down to a certain size for Facebook, you can actually program it. It'll always take them down to like something like 1200 as a time saver. But I'm usually doing something like we're doing, so I don't hit that. I'm usually hitting this resize up here. And then the width on that smaller one was what? 5.4, okay, 9.4. Now notice if I have aspect ratio turned on, that second number isn't right, is it?
Yeah.
That's the whole point of while, you know, they're slightly different, so we're going to have to turn off to lock in the aspect ratio. Also, I had to turn that off when I was resizing the George Washington Bridge, so it could distort the image slightly. So now in here, so we're on, what's our height on our first one?
3276.
So then all we do is then hit resize and save, that button right there. And that will take just a few seconds, and it will be saved it back. Where does everything we save go?
Camera roll.
And something else, for, you know, some of you know this and some of you probably don't. Whenever we do a save from any app on our iPhones or iPads, it's like if we're working on our computer, on our Mac or PC, it's like a save as. You're never going to damage your original file. That's a good thing, isn't it? It'll always be a save as. Now, what's the downside to that? Well, you have all these iterations of images, which can get kind of out of control. Okay, let's look at our camera roll and see what we got. These are the two that would not work. So I think we resize. Our goal was to resize this one to match this one, right? And that would be it. So we're going to put this one together with this one. And if we did it wrong, we'll do it again. It's not nothing. You know, you might still pass the class. So let's go into True HDR and choose No Thanks. Remind me later. I should just hit No Thanks. Choose pictures. Let's go to camera roll, and now I want to do this one, this light one, and this dark one. You agree?
Yeah.
Okay. So we'll take that one, and I say now choose the second image here. But these are so big, it takes a moment after the tap. So we'll tap on that dark one, and now we should not. If you guys did your part of this, and there they are. Now let's hold your breath. I think we even got that message before this step, didn't we? So let's tap merge, pre-processing, estimating transformations, aligning images, clearing earwax. It goes all through all these steps. Combining dynamic range, that's a good thing. And it's only got a couple more. How many people with a new iPad think they run too hot? It's much ado about nothing, isn't it? Yeah, I mean, apparently gamers, if you're running some of those really powerful games. Now look at that. Ooh, isn't that looking nice? Now look, let's leave these at their default. We're not even going to monkey with these, just like I did with those other ones. Then we'll do an A-B comparison, okay? So let's just hit save, and that puts that in our camera roll. And let's go look at those two side by side, okay? So let's go back to our camera roll. And here's the one that I did before coming to class. There you can see it, but even on the thumbnail, it's going to be hard because they're not next to one another to go back and forth. So I want you to see the thumbnail. But look at that. The shadows are more open, aren't they? And the sky is richer. So like I said, start with the easiest method first. If you like it, you're finished. But if you're not, invest some more time. This does take more steps, but your tonality can be much nicer. Isn't that sweet? And it looks much better, of course, here on the screen here, especially with the Retina display. And then, of course, that's going to have to be cropped. Every time you stitch, you're going to be cropping your image, to get that scallop out. There's no way around that. Now, we talked about those two methods, the all-in-one bucket, the easy method. Then this was doing the lights and then the darks, and then we had to resize them. We had that intermediate step of resizing to make a match, or we got stalled with the HDR program that wouldn't allow us to put dissimilar size images together. But there's what would the third way be? Where you did on every dark light pair, where you do HDR processing on every pair and then save those and then stitch those together. Now that's a time consuming ordeal, isn't it? Frankly, I've never done it. But I just want to be fair to you guys, it may give you even better tonality. But I think this just works so well. And now let's jump into another app. Because there's some things that we just cannot miss talking about here. We got so much to cover. I hope some of you come up in May for the workshop up in the Catskills. How many of you have used Snapseed from Nick? I mean, all your hands should go up, and it goes periodically on sale for free. Nick's software for your desktop is dynamite, and Nick's software, this program, is dynamite here. They only need to make two additions. They need to put a gradient tool in here and let us zoom up the image to examine it, and they'd have a nearly perfect app. Let's launch Snapseed. How many of you use Nick's software on your computers, on your Mac or PC? About the same number. It's good stuff. All their software is good. Now, this is obviously too good an image to be one of mine. That's their splash thing. Sample image. That's done by a real photographer. Let's hit open image and go. You could shoot from here, but we're going to open that last image that we just put together. Now, we talk about workflow. Well, obviously, workflow is going to be to crop. And I always tell people, especially those of us that have worked in the classic wet dark room, digitally, if you follow the same kind of steps you'd use in the dark room, what's the first thing you do under the audio? Well, you decide what size image you're going to print, right? By where you put your easel blades, So let's go over. These are all the different things down here at the bottom, from automatic. See, if we scoot across here, they have all these different things which we can do. It's very nicely organized. And you're going to like, for those of you who haven't seen this before, you're going to be impressed. So we're going to crop it. So let's tap crop. And sometimes you think, well, how does this stuff work? What do I do? Well, every screen will have a little question mark up here. And let's tap on that. And they give you this really nice little on-screen tutorial on how to do stuff. And first of all, it's important, tap anywhere to dismiss this. Drag any edge or corner to adjust the crop. Use pinch gesture to keep the current aspect ratio. So very, very neat. So we can move these in. Notice how we want to bring that down to get rid of that skull. Now sometimes, in fact, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to intentionally leave a little bit of that scalloped up there because if, you know, otherwise I have to come down too far to get rid of all that scallop. So I'm going to, in fact, I'll just to save a little time, I'll just come down. I'm going to leave. Oh no, heck, why not? Let's leave a bunch of it. I'm going to leave a bunch of scalloped up in that corner, and I think everywhere else except down. Well, I'll even leave that at the bottom. Why would I leave that? Isn't that going to be a pain to fix? No. It's going to be very easy to what? Clone. No. Cloning's old school. What do we use instead in Photoshop? The healing brush, right? Isn't the healing brush like an intelligent clone tool? If we use the clone stamp, you always have to use a soft brush with a clone stamp in Photoshop. And what happens? You get blurry, you get overlap, and it blurs it. It mushes out your image. You can't use a hard brush because then it looks like cardboard, like someone took a round stamp. Well, the healing brush separates chroma and luminosity from texture. That's kind of geek talk, but what it means is it's better. It's better. It matches the textural component of your image, and we have that here. So I'm going to leave intentionally these two spots up there and down here, and time permitting, we'll do that. Now, how do I apply this crop? Remember, and we could hit the little question mark. That's applied. You can even read it right there. They let you lock, if you wanted to lock aspect ratios, if you wanted to be 3x4, 2x3, like a 35 or a digital SLR, you could do that. But we don't, we're going to go with what we have here. Now, let's just touch upon a few of these extra controls they have in here. Automatic's kind of cool, you can play with that. But this is one of the most powerful ones, the selective adjust. So there's a lot we're not going to do in here, but we want to expose you to some of the most powerful ones. Selective adjust is amazing. And I'll show you how it works. I'm going to tap on there, and it brings up the controls. Oh, it looks like I missed a little stuff over there. I should have cropped that a little better. I didn't see that, but that's okay. Now, notice here, we say, well, how does that work? Well, you know what to do. You tap that, and it tells you all the little steps, which I'm going to do. We're going to add a control point. I'm going to darken. This corner up here is a little light, isn't it, compared to the rest of the sky? Do you agree? The viewer's eye is kind of being drawn out of that upper right corner. So let's tap on add a control point. And then it's highlighted, so I'm just going to tap with the finger up there, up in that upper right, and it says B. That means stands for make it better. No, that's for brightness. Now, this is so beautifully done. I think what Nick has done, they've come up with the best interface to take advantage of the way we work. You know, the new 4/3 cameras, I don't think, did Nikon and Canon do this on their latest cameras? I mean, like the Olympus now, you can move, it's a touch screen. In fact, you can even touch where you want it to focus on the LCD on the back. How natural is that? That's what we do with our iPhones. Why would you not have that on a camera? So if Nikon and Canon haven't put that in their new, they've missed the boat. They've missed the boat. So B stands for brightness. Now, what's so cool about their interface, watch, I'm going to touch the screen, and watch as I move my finger up and down. I'm just moving my, look at this. You choose, the B stood for brightness, so we can change brightness, contrast, or saturation. So if I go to brightness, that's up and down to choose the control, and then I just go left or right. Look at this, you go left or right with your finger. Isn't that nice? Isn't that slicker than deer guts on a doorknob? You don't have to edit that one. Okay, now if we take the contrast up a little bit in that area, look at that, we can make that like the little variations in the cloud. It's getting a little blue, so I might change the saturation, take the saturation out a little bit. And then we have a compare button down here. So it's sort of like preview in Photoshop. So watch, look at that, isn't that beautiful? Now, what do you say? Well, that's affecting too big of an area. It's kind of moving over into that cloud. Well, look, if I tap with two fingers, look, I'm doing a pinch reverse pinch. It shows what they call the area of influence. Now, it's not a circular area necessarily. It's actually sensitive to the color and the luminosity of where that point is. So yes, you see the metaphor is a circle, but the selection will not always be circular. Does that make sense? So you can dial that up and down. Now, what if you like that effect, but you'd like to put it somewhere else? Well, watch, I'm going to tap on that, and I could delete it, but I'm going to do copy. And then I'm going to come down to like this area over here and tap and do paste. So I said do paste. There it is. And then I can make that one bigger, and look at that. So it copied, like this is the parent, it copied those attributes. So I didn't have to start from scratch. Now they say it's a little too dark. Well, I'll go up and down to choose brightness for that area and brighten it up a little bit. Go on. Isn't that beautiful? And it shows you as you're going left to right, see that little red, see if you're going up or down. If you're going up in brightness, it goes green. If you're going down, it goes, but it also shows you down here whether you're going down, below normal, or up from where it was. It's a thing of beauty, is it not? So this is dynamite. Now I want to show you that it's not just a circuit or sensitivity. Let's add a control point like to the peak of the building here. Let's tap add and tap on there. And you see how, look at that. See the area it's selecting? So it's not selecting that whole area. It's really biasing the influence in that peak. So I can go up on that, and I could go take the contrast up a little bit on that, and also take the saturation down a little bit in there. And we'll do a little compare on that. Isn't that nice? Now there's a limit, I think it's like 7 or 8 control points that you can put on there, and then the little plus will be grayed out. But it's no big deal. You could hit apply and then come back here to selective adjustment again and do another 7 or 8. So they just kind of limit it to how many you can do at one time. So this is just a great app for that kind of stuff. Let's apply that. And I just want to talk about a couple of other little features in here in Nick. I know you got to get this one and play with it. This is a universal app. What do I mean by universal? Yeah, like this lady said, use it on, it works without buying it twice on your iPhone and iPad. This would be also a good time to talk about if you and a partner or spouse or friend share an iTunes account, up to 6 iOS devices, legally, this is part of the plan, you get to share. So if Jill buys an app, I get it free. That's part of the deal. So up to 6 different devices. So 3 people could have iPads and iPhones, and all 6 of you buy it one time for like 99 cents or something. And on these 6 devices, you'd have it free. I mean, you're not violating copyright or anything. It's part of the deal. Very courteous. So when you go to the App Store, if you see a little plus in the corner where it says the price, that means it's universal. Some apps will get you twice. They'll have like an HD version for the iPad and a normal version. But Nick is one of the courteous vendors, so you get it one time and it works on both your iPhone and your iPad.
I thought the plus meant iPad.
No, the plus means it's universal.
Okay.
Yeah, and then you can also read the description. And now you want to read the descriptions now, especially if you have one of the new iPads, because it will say whether it's optimized for the Retina display. It'd be nice if they had some little icon for that you didn't have to read. They need to come up with like a little eyeball or something, you know.
I just pulled that up. It's $4.99.
This is $4.99? Ooh, good grief. You have to save like 3 weeks for that. I would with my allowance. But okay, now let's just look at a couple of these others. Tune image is another good one. Let's look at tune image. We're not going to do all these, but some of the more important. So it loads up the set of options there. And look at this. We got brightness, ambiance, contrast. Let's look at ambience. What does that do? Oh, look at that. And I'm taking my finger up and down. So especially for your screen, that's kind of nice, isn't it? And then you have a white balance, saturation. So you could take, of course, you could make it look like stuff on the web, or you could make it look monochromatic, or you could make it look a little bit like almost like a hand-colored black and white. But we'll kind of leave it like that. And then we'll hit apply. We're just playing here, right? Now, the other one I want to show you here, when you hit apply, it does the real math very quickly, even on an 18 megapixel image. You can straighten, you can crop. Details. Now this, they say new, and this is very, very nice. Details is great. And there are only 2 things, and I'm just taking my finger up and down, sharpening and structure. It always comes up on sharpening. I kind of wish it came up on structure by default, but it doesn't. Now, watch, I'm going to slide to the right. You saw something change there, didn't you? Notice we can't zoom into the image. If I try to zoom, nothing happens. I can just switch back and forth. But we do have a loop. So I wish they would give us the ability to zoom in, but you can tap on that loop and move it around. So we park it like up on the corner of that window. Watch as I hit the compare button. See the difference? So you see it overall, and you do. And let's put some sharpening in there too. And so, you know, so you really see it. I'll crank in a lot. So this is pretty nice. You do get to see. You don't get to see it, you know, at 100%, but you can move that loop around to different areas, like down here on the grass, for instance. You can see with and without. Now I've gone overboard there, so you can see it better up on screen. But this is very nice. You know, we went super high on both those, just so you could see it. But we do something a little more reasonable, and something like that, and apply that. So now let me just show you a couple more other. You can play with black and white, vintage. Drama is kind of cool. I just want to show you drama. It's different, and they give you filter strength and saturation. And look out, right out of the can. Look what it does. That's kind of nice. That's sort of like a tone map feel, isn't it? It has like enhanced local contrast. Now they do give you styles. Notice there's a little extra star button. If you tap that, they give you different styles you can play with. And we're not going to take the time to play with all those. But there's a lot to do in here. And then of course filter strength, and that's all the way up. But we could take that down some. Maybe you want just a little bit of that in there. And saturation, you could take the saturation up. But I think it's kind of nice when you take it down a little bit. So isn't that nice? I kind of like that. Let's say apply. Now we could have saved, in fact it's even safer if, as you go through here, every time after you hit apply and you process it, we could always go up here to save. On your iPhone it will be up in the corner, but on your iPad it's save. I'm going to go ahead and save this. You could have saved it at each step, right? So, because there is no undo, you can revert. Did I hit save? I meant to hit. There it goes. You can revert, but that takes you all the way back to the way you started. And that's something, I wish they had a little history panel that you could take. And I say, I really like everything except that last like sharpening idea. But they don't, you'd have to start over. Now we save that. Let's go take a look at that guy that we just saved. That goes into.
You were going to show us how to fill in the.
Yeah, that's what I'm going to do. Yeah, I'm going to show that. But I want to take a look at that. So we took that guy and cropped it and turned it into this guy. And it looks, boy, look at that. And on my screen here, this Retina display, it's so much better than up there. It's just amazing. But projector, it's a good projector, but they're all. Okay, the question is, how do we get rid of this? And I don't care about that, I missed that, but, and this up here. Well, there's an app called, and Retouch and Frame, whoops, you're not seeing, why is that not going to, there it goes. There's a little bit of lag. In this folder called Retouch and Frame, you know, I've just grouped these to kind of make sense, right? There's an app called Retouch. Let's launch that, Retouch. And, you know, I'm going to go into, I'm going to go into settings here, and always max resolution, no. Yeah, that's done. Just to speed things up. Open photo from gallery. We'll go into our camera roll. It's that last one. So I didn't want to crop out. I'm going to open low resolution. I'm only opening low so it happens faster. You would, of course, do the maximum. Okay, so I didn't want to crop this because I like that sky. I didn't want to crop this because I like that. So our goal is to fill those areas in. And this app is beautiful, and I think it might have gone from 99 up to $1.99. You can either lasso the area or paint it. It's 6 of 1, half a dozen of another. I usually prefer painting. And when you tap that, then you have a slider for your brush size. And see how it brings that up? Now notice there's no setting for softness because we don't need it. So I'm going to choose a brush that's big enough to cover that area. And then, and I'm going to use, we have some styluses for sale, by the way. I really like working with a stylus rather than a big finger. So I'm going to come over and just paint over that area up there in the sky like that. And I'll even, to save time, hit this with a kind of a big brush. And I will make my brush smaller and hit this little area over here on that right. And notice as I'm doing that, in fact, in that upper left corner, see how I left a little skull up there? Notice when I touch, see how it gives that blow up view, and I did too much. So let's take the eraser tool and come in here and erase some of that away. But isn't that nice? It gives you that blow up corner. So your finger or your stylus isn't over what you're trying to do. And it moves automatically, so it's never over what you're doing. It's a very, very good program. I'm going to erase a little bit of this too, since I went kind of wild down there. So, you know, we don't have to have more than, you know, ridiculously too much. So let's hit the little button here that says start. You can barely read that, but that little arrow. You can clone. Notice they do give you a clone tool. And just like in Photoshop, sometimes you do have to clone because the way the healing brushes in Photoshop or here, they kind of match textures. Sometimes if you're next to a dark area, they'll kind of suck in that darkness and it'll drive you crazy and you try to make a selection and it still doesn't work. So sometimes you might have to clone. They do give you that, but if you can make the healing brush work, it'll be a lot better. So I hit apply, it's processing the image. How nice is that? How nice is that? Pretty darn nice, huh? And yeah, it's just, and you can undo stuff. You do have multiple undos. So up here at the top, if we hit undo, look at that. You can undo every step you did, even where I erased that stuff. But that's pretty cool. And you zoom in on that. We did low res just to save time, but there's like no telltale problem. I mean, it's just really, it's a very, very good, very good app. And then you hit the save icon, save to library, and that's a smaller version of that. Now, I want to show you something else. In that same retouch and frame folder, I keep an app called Liquid Scale. And this is pretty amazing. And does this honor sideways? This is one of their, whoops, I'm sorry, I just hit my home button. This is one of their demo images, but let's load here. I'm going to load an image from the camera roll, and I saved one that's a really nice image by a good friend, David Jeffrey, and here it is. It's a beautiful image. He did an HDR of this train. And Dave Jeffrey, yeah, he's not an up-and-comer, he's up, and does beautiful work, especially in HDR. But when we look at this print, I said, boy, Dave, I said, I really wish, and this, he let me take a picture of his print with the iPhone. So this is like second generation. He had this beautiful print, and then under fluorescent light, I take a picture with the iPhone. I said, if we could eliminate a little bit, now he had detail in this highlight, that's just like a reflection with the iPhone to cook that. His image had much nicer detail and shadows too. But if we could close up this area to kind of make this this adjacent boxcar coming in to make the intimacy a little stronger. So watch what we're going to do. We're going to come in here and we're going to choose. See down here, I'm going to choose. See this little plus and minus guy? I'm going to paint with green over stuff that I don't want to change shape. And that would be like the locomotive, right? So I'm going to paint with over the locomotive. That I don't want that to be distorted. So what we're doing here is like content-aware fill. And then I'll paint over, I don't want this really to be distorted, this boxcar, so in green we'll protect that. And I'll just try to, and we won't do a perfect job. I don't want that to be really changed up too much either over there. But this area I want to close up, so I'm going to take red and paint in here. So this is the stuff that I really want to kind of collapse down. So I don't want to distort the locomotive. So now we're going to hit done. And watch these little, see these little hot dogs growing towards the center? So it's pre-processing the image. Now watch, now this is pretty cosmic. I'm going to take a finger and tap one of these and watch and push in. And look at that. Wow. Pretty nice, huh? It's called liquid scale. Liquid scale. And that's just like content-aware scale. So you've told it where the important parts of the image are that you don't want to be distorted, and where the sacrificial parts of the image are that you do want to crush down. And then, of course, you would hit save and save that to your camera roll. Pretty amazing, is it not? Now, iPhoto just came out, and it's very good. If you use iPhoto on a Mac, you'll be very familiar with it, but there are lots of ways to learn about that. I do want to show you something very important, Photo Forge 2, which gives, should I do that? Yeah, I guess I should, which gives us wonderful layering. How many of you love layers in Photoshop? How many of you are terrified of layers in Photoshop? A few. Let me take just 1 minute to show you something. Do I have a folder called layers in here? Did you see a folder called layers? I usually have top left. Yeah, I'm going to show you, this is an app I do not recommend you buy. Because it's resolution hampered. But I want to show you what is good about it, and we'll open up this one image. What's good is, look at this, the layers are shown three-dimensionally. You can have up to five. So instructionally, I've been able to show, look, I can take my finger and move the order of those layers. That's the way Photoshop should be. It's better, but the resolution is terrible. It's like 600 by 800 or something. But I've shown people that cannot understand layers in Photoshop. I've launched this little app called Layers and shown them this. They say, oh, now I get it. And you can tap on, like, we got that top layer selected. If I tap the More button, then you can set layer transparency. And look at that. And you see it. Isn't that nice? This is the way Photoshop should be instead of this impersonal two-dimensional column. Now, Photoshop 6, they've changed the interface, but I doubt if it's this good. Okay, but you don't want to get that unless you're teaching because it has a resolution problem. I just want to touch, this is Photo Forge 2. There is an original Photo Forge up here, but with Photo Forge 2, they give you unlimited layers. And I'll just show you a couple. This has its own library. You have to import your image into here and then build it. So here's an image I did in New Mexico last year. I don't even remember how many layers this has. But this just has three layers. And you can turn off any one of those. So like that top layer, what do you think this little inset is here? It's a mask. So you have, like in Photoshop, you have masks. So you have layers and layer masks. And you also have, on that top layer, I can turn it off. And let's see what that does when I turn it off. Did you see it change? So I just tap that eyeball and turned off the visibility. Let's turn it back on. But we also have, actually that's kind of out of registration. I guess I was doing something demo-wise with this. But you also have, let's look at this middle guy here. You also have blending modes with this. You can change the blending mode just like in Photoshop. Now obviously in a 2-hour session, we can't spend much time on here. But if you like working with layers, you'll love this. Now it's not a perfect app. And once you, every time you save, unlike we talked about Photoshop, Adobe's new Photoshop Touch, where if you save it to the Creative Cloud as a PSDX file, it will have those layers, but the resolution's bad, whereas this resolution is very good. But once you save it, it is a flat JPEG again. You can't get those layers out of PhotoForge 2. But if you're building an image and you need to do composites and stuff, it can be an extremely powerful tool for you. And it keeps all of your images in here in its own library. And you can see these are, there's a little cafe racer I built last year. And that was not a money pit. And it's fun. So you can put things together and they stay in here. Now here's a tip. You might find, I found this out on my iPhone 4, that I was running out of storage space. And I thought, you know, I'd cleared off images, I'd cleared off all this stuff. I was down to only like 500 apps. And and was still running out of space. These, even though these are not, don't have that many layers and aren't that huge, they're stored very, for lack of a better term, inefficiently. And I deleted like 3 of these layered images out of here, and I got like 2 gigs of space back. So if you got a lot, the way they store them in their internal library, the nice thing is those layers stay. This was a student image from Santa Fe last year, and we were using for demo. And I wish I could remember her name and give her credit because she did beautiful work, but I'm sorry I forget. But there you can see the 2 layers. But yeah, you might want to, you know, if you don't need the layers anymore, save them as a flat image and get out. But very, very powerful program. Boy, there's just too much. If you love doing, if you're kind of a geek on when does the sun come up and when does it go down, how many of you have some of these things like Sunseeker? You do need an internet connection, which we don't have at the moment. But this guy, you can hold this up and pivot around. We'll go into 3, and it will show you actually where the sun is now. Look at that. And as I pivot around the room, and look, as I pivot, it is working. That's showing the whole arc of what the sun's going to do. It's going to come up over there. That green line is your horizon. So if you want to know, let's say I want the sun, where will it, when, at noon, the sun, I want to shoot when the sun's up there at 12 o'clock. So I'll know that's where I want to be. It's amazing. And you pivot around, it shows you on screen where the sun's going to be at any time during the day. There's just so much. You know, this, I described the iPhone and the iPad. They're problem solvers. They just do so much. Apps for adding texture. We talked about stitching some apps for adding texture. This Photo Studio. This is one that they do get you with an HD version. So you buy it once for your iPhone, then you spend money again. But it's a very good app. There's so many filters in here, it'll drive you crazy. I'm not even going to take the time. Here's an app that I'm kind of hot on right now. Whoops, I'm going to launch it. It's called Laminar. And Laminar will only run on the iPad. Restore previous session, yes. And what I like about this, I'm sorry, I hit the off button there. Sorry, I didn't mean to do that. It's restoring the last session. It does not have its own internal library. I wish it did. Maybe on a future update it will. So it's trying to restore my previous session. So look, these are the layers. Now when you first look at this, it's kind of overwhelming, but once you study it, it makes sense. So there's your layer panel. Notice you have a button called masked. So like on that top layer, I'll tap on that. If I tap on the mask, and I'm sorry, it's kind of, let me brighten that up. So we'll with the curve over here, we'll brighten that up some. Isn't that nice? Have to brighten it a lot for your screen. But if I'd want to mask and not have that texture from that layer show in certain area, I would tap the mask icon. And then I can come in here and choose what size brush do I want to use. You can change your brush in both axes. I want the softness, I want it to be very soft. And the opacity to be kind of medium. So I could come on here and paint and hide. You see how you're seeing the checkerboard? So, and it is cumulative or additive. As I go back and forth with layer opacity, it builds up like it would with flow in Photoshop. That's why in Photoshop, I don't like opacity. Opacity is like a governor. It limits you within that one brush stroke. flow, you can do what we just did here, and you can choose a low opacity, and you can build up the effect, which is a much more controllable way to work. So if we like that, we say, okay, apply, I hit the little check mark. Then, and I'm sorry if this image in particular looks very dark up here, but then we just hid that layer's content in that area, and there it's showing the mask, what we just painted. It does not, the downside of this app, Laminar, it does not have an internal library, so you can only work on one image at a time, and once you save it, you lose your layers. Hopefully they will add that internal library like PhotoForge 2. But actually, the masking is actually more intuitive yet. Their curve implementation is very good. You can go to any layer and apply and change the curve on it. It's a very powerful thing. And this is, if memory serves, this is iPad only. And because, can you imagine trying to get that much stuff on the real estate of an iPhone? They couldn't. I mean, we love this. It's amazing. I love working on the small thing. But then you work, especially with this new iPad with the high resolution screen, it blows you away on what you can do. So Laminar, that you also have your blending modes down here you can change. You can delete layers, you can clone. Clone means duplicate layer. They just chose the word clone. So wonderful stuff in there. So there's a reminder for questions. Okay, so let me pause here at 10 minutes till 6. So did we cover enough for you? You can't in 2 hours, can you? You just can't. Yes, ma'am. It's an app called Bracket Mode. The question is about Bracket Mode. And its only goal in life is to give you a dark exposure and a light with one tap of the shutter button. And you can, in automatic mode, it will automatically find the darkest and lightest. But I recommend tapping that little icon down there in the lower left, and I'll real fast show you where's my HDR? Things move when you go vertical and I lose place. There's HDR, there's Bracket Mode. I recommend tapping this little icon down here where you get to choose, you get to locate those, because sometimes, like if I were taking a picture of you guys, sometimes it will place the dark selection in particular on an area that's so dark. You might be doing a landscape and there's like a pile of coal in the shade. You don't care about shadow detail, but it will result in such overexposure, it'll bias and really wreck your picture. So you could manually move that instead of having it be down like there. You might move it over to another dark area like Jill's butt there. And have it meter there, or say an area back in here where the shadow detail is more viable. Or say, what if it went on the surface, if you have the sun in your picture, which isn't a good thing to do because it could hurt your sensor, but like a super bright area where you don't care about detail, you might move it over to like a more appropriate area. So that's why tapping that lower left icon, going into manual mode, and manually choosing those areas. Now, just keep in mind, if you're combining this with with stitching, it does not relocate every time when you pivot. So you're going to want to hit, daggone, I hit my home button again. I apologize. You want to, every time you pivot, if you're doing stitching, you want to tap once to clear and once to bring back those. I like to see where does it pick those areas. So here I might move it up on this gentleman up there. Down here, it's too, I don't care about way down there in that crevice, but so to speak. But up here, it's a more important shadow detail. And I consider that highlighted there. I might come over here or somewhere else on the bright ceiling. So you get to dial in. You get to make judicious decisions about where are the important lights and darks, rather than, it's like do you keep your camera in P or M or A, Same kind of difference. Thank you for asking. Yes, ma'am.
So which of the camera apps, assuming you're not using the iPhone's camera that comes with it, which is the primary one that you use?
Right now, my camera of choice for the month, and it changes, is King Camera. And let's launch King Camera. And this will probably give you even more options because we don't have a flash, for instance, on the iPad 3 does not have a flash. But I'll just show you quickly why I like this so much. And Jill's, I'll aim this over at these people instead of over always at Jill. So though I like looking at Jill. Oh, there's a picture of a neighbor. It has its own little internal library and it saves the image of the neighbor kid who stopped in, really cool kid. But here's one of the things I like. If I tap like on this gentleman, see it's metering there, right? It's metering and exposing. If I tap back on that bright doorway, see how dark it gets? So it's doing just like the built-in app. It's metering and focusing there. But if I tap and hold on the screen, look at that. Now I can separate, so I could keep the focus on this gentleman's face, but I could dial in, like that's kind of like a gray card on the floor, isn't it? So I could meter there, isn't that nice? Or I could do manual HDR and do one shot there and one shot here. So that's why these are so valuable. Now, Pro Camera will do that, Camera Plus will do that. And then how do you get them back together again? Well, if you just tap somewhere on the screen, it puts them back together and you just get the little square. So you tap and hold to get those reticles that you can separate. Now, I like their icons too. The one that's the sun, looks like the sun is gonna be your exposure, right? So those are very cool. Now, here's the other thing I like about their interface. I'm gonna swipe my finger from the right edge out and watch what happens. It brings out this like drawer of controls. Including, see this one called Big? It turns, watch when I tap that. It's a big button. I can tap anywhere on the frame to take the picture. You know, we've all done this. You're trying to drive and take pictures. Yeah. After the third time you get arrested, then you might reconsider. But up until that point, it's fun. But no, we always do that. Or, you know, but you're handing it to someone. Well, now you just tap anywhere on there. So I just tap anywhere, and it will take the picture. So that's pretty nice. And on your phone, it's really good because, you know, you're driving, you're trying to grab your finger to get it down here. So you just tap anywhere on the screen. It's really good. But they also, I'll turn that off. They also give you this cool stuff. You can have a self timer. You can have vibration reduction. Or what was the ear? What do you think the ear icon is doing?
Clapper.
Yeah, it's a sound trigger. And it even, so you can like snap your finger. So if you're doing a group shot, you can snap your fingers. It would take the picture. And it even samples the ambient noise first. So it won't trigger on just any little sound of like rustling of the leaves or something. It's only when you do something above and beyond the base level of noise in your environment. And it also has rapid shot, but I just love to be able to get in there and do this kind of stuff. You know, you have switching feature. You can do, yeah, I mean, the list just goes on and on of what this thing will do. It's just amazing. And I love that interface. Oh, exposure come. Oh, there's your self timer. You can choose, look at this, you tap there. On your self timer, you can have, look at this, you can have 20 seconds, up to 30 seconds, see 5, 10, 20, or 30 seconds on your self timer. It's they've just put a lot of really good stuff in. You can have grid lines. So it's just a King Camera has a lot of good stuff. And something else they have, which is very valuable, if you tap on the gear icon down here, they have some wonderful video tutorials. And when you launch these, it does not take you to a website. These are built into the app. So no matter where, I hate it when it launches Safari and you're waiting for that if you don't have an internet connection or if it's slow. Right. These are included in the app, so you get some really good training right in the app itself. So that's something you can appreciate too, isn't it? The answer to the second part of your question about the iPads heating up, you read articles, I think it's a non-issue. Maybe the hardcore gamers, the kids that are running these amazing graphics, because the quad-core, the graphics processing unit in the iPad 3 or what they call the new iPad is, you know, that's why the battery light got 70% bigger. It's all battery. So yeah, if you're a hardcore gamer, it might get up hot, but I just saw a chart today. There are other tablets that get hotter. I think it's a non-issue. Is it warmer than the iPad 2? Yes. But is it a big deal? No. Now about storage. For photography, absolutely. The screen is an amazing screen. I mean, other than the screen, the dictation is nice for email. It doesn't have Siri, but it does have dictation. You know, you hit the microphone, it does an amazingly good job. It does not have Siri. But, you know, there are not a lot of other things that it does over the iPad. The camera's much better, not the front-facing for FaceTime, but the back camera is much better. It's 4 megapixels instead of like two-thirds, or 5 megapixels instead of like two-thirds of a megapixel. But the screen is the draw, and it's an amazing screen for working on images, for reading, et cetera. Now, let me just answer the second part of that question about storage. If you're shooting a lot of images, sometimes I will have like on my iPhone like 4,000 images. And if you also want to have music, so when you're traveling, you can, you know, play it through your car radio and stuff. So the 64 gig, you're always going to get back some of that extra $100 anyway when you sell it or pass it down to someone, right? So don't get the 16. Get at least the 32. But you never, you always want more space. You know, it's like you'll fill whatever you have, right? So you might as well get the 64 and be done with it.
I've been using this for 2 hours and there's no heat.
Yeah. Yeah, but you're not playing some game, you know. Yes, sir.
Are you aware of any good Samaritan who has like a database on the web that says which apps have which features?
Oh, a database where they break down. There might be such a thing, but I don't know where it is. There's some sites, iPhoneography. You might Google like a photo app feature list or something. Someone's probably had the courtesy to do that. Now, a little bit of that will be in that PDF that I send you, but it's not the definitive list by any means.
Where do you surveil for new apps?
Oh, the question is where, I'll tell you what, how do you find like new apps? What I recommend, there are obviously there are so many apps. Once you get into it, what I do is every day I go to the app store. Well, no, that's not a laugh line. It's true. And we're not on Wi-Fi here. I don't think we're on. Who knows what we're on? But you go to the app store and you sort by date released. See, and so if you do this at least like three times a week, you'll be able to keep track of at least the new ones coming on the scene, and you can read the reviews. Now be careful, because some of them won't tell you, especially the photo app, they won't tell you, if they don't tell you about the resolution, like, you know, keeps full resolution, be suspicious. But sometimes it's new, but you know what you're gonna do? If you gamble, if you spend your 99 cents, you don't know, you're gonna take a picture or edit a picture, then you're gonna use Danny Goodman's photo size to see, did this just trash my res or did it honor it? And then you can write a review. Nice features, but threw away my res, so I dumped it. You know, kind of thing. So I'm sorry the day went so quickly. There's like 10 times as much. Try to take a workshop up in the Catskills from me. But thank you very much for your attention and for giving up your valuable 2 hours of the day. And thanks a lot.
For more information, please visit us online, give us a call, or stop by our New York City Superstore. You can also connect with us on the web.